song, and every time it gives me chills. Amen? What a powerful, powerful rendition. We appreciate that very much. John chapter 20, if you have your Bibles, verse 1 through 9, amen. If I get too loud, I'm sorry. I'm not going to quiet down, but I'm sorry. Amen. When I was in Africa, and I can remember our first Easter Sunday morning service, that I got behind the pulpit and I shouted, "Jesus Christ is risen from the dead!" And I was not prepared for the answer. The entire church, running roughly 500-600 people, jumped to their feet. The ladies began doing their whatever that thing is that they do. Aaron can do it, I can't do it. But then they began doing their lady dance. And then the guys are clapping and jumping up and down and they're excited. And we didn't have a cement floor yet, so all the dust from the dirt began to kick up. Pretty soon, you could not see anything. It was completely just a blackout of dust. And that place just kept going because to them, the resurrection from the dead is everything. That's the power of God and the salvation. Hallelujah. Ronald Reagan, once on an Easter message, said this. He said, "Meaning no disrespect to the religious convictions of others, I still can't help wondering how we can explain away what to me is the greatest miracle of all and which is recorded in history. No one denies that there was such a man, that he lived and that he was put to death by crucifixion. Where is the miracle I spoke of? Well, consider this and let your imagination translate the story into your own time, possibly your own hometown. A young man whose father is a carpenter grows up working in his father's shop, and one day he puts down his tools and he walks out of his father's shop. He starts preaching on the street corners and in the nearby countryside, walking from place to place, preaching all the while. Even though he's not an ordained minister, he does this for 3 years. Then he's arrested. He's tried and he's convicted. There is no court of appeal. So he is executed at the age of 33 along with two common thieves. Those in charge of this execution roll the dice to see who gets his clothing when it's all over. The only possessions he has. His family cannot afford a burial place for him, so he is interred in a borrowed tomb. End of story? Not hardly. No, this uneducated, propertyless young man who left no written word has, for 2,000 years, had a greater effect on the world than all the rulers, kings, emperors, than all the conquerors, generals, and admirals, than all the scholars, scientists, and philosophers who have ever lived."
Amen.
All of them put together. How do we explain that? How do we explain that? Unless, of course, he really was who he said he was.
Yes.
Ronald Reagan, one of the greatest presidents that ever lived. In the final days of Jesus' ministry, it appeared to the disciples that everything that they had worked for had fallen apart. During the course of his ministry, the disciples had come to believe one by one that he was the Messiah. They had seen him heal the sick, perform miracles, raise people from the dead even. They believed that he would soon establish God's kingdom here on earth, a kingdom that would be complete and would complete with and ultimately defeat the Roman Empire. Only it didn't happen that way. Somehow, things began to unravel. Judas Iscariot betrayed him, arranging for him to be arrested. Jesus was put on trial for treason, found guilty, sentenced to death. In the final hours of his life, all but one of his disciples deserted him. From all appearances, his plan to save the world had failed. The dream they shared together suddenly ended in despair. But as you know, church, that's not how the story ends. Come on, somebody. In fact, the only reason that we are here this morning is because the story has a different ending altogether. See, you know what happened. After Jesus died on the cross, on Friday evening, he was placed in a borrowed tomb. On the third day, Sunday morning, he was raised from the dead. Hey, man, this is the significance of Easter. This is what distinguishes Christianity from every other world religion. We're not here to pay homage to our dead founder this morning.
Amen.
We're here to celebrate the one who died and rose from the dead. He's alive forevermore. That's what we're here for. That's why we're in this place. That's why we're in the house of God. Amen. We're here to celebrate the one that can even destroy death.
Amen.
John chapter 20, our text this morning, verse 1 through 9. The Bible says on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went into the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him." Peter therefore went out to the other disciples, and they were going to the tomb. So they both ran together. The other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloth lying there, and it did not go in. And Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloth lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the other linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet he did not know the scripture, that he might rise again from the dead. See, the resurrection conquers defeat. The resurrection conquers failure. The lesson that the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ teaches is that there is no defeat that anyone can experience. Church, listen to me. In life, that God cannot turn into victory. There is nothing that you have done, that you failed at, that you've messed up. There's nothing, no decision, no choice that you made that is completely down the tubes and ridiculously unable to change. God can turn everything in your life into victory. Get this letter.
Yes, amen.
There is no failure that God cannot turn into success. There is no life so broken by sin that God cannot turn into a life that gives him glory. We have heroin addicts, former heroin addicts. We have former meth addicts. We have people that have had a horrible time, that have made the worst possible decisions that he can make in their lives. And they're here in ties and shirts, wearing deodorant. Radically tatted up, of course, but serving the Lord with their whole heart. What a powerful, powerful truth. Come on, say, there is no failure that God cannot turn around. Everyone here today has experienced some kind of defeat in their lives. Some of you have been defeated in your marriage. Some of you have been defeated in your relationship with your children and or with your parents. Some of you have been defeated by drugs or alcohol or sex or some other behavior or addiction that you cannot control. Some have been defeated by your own selfish, sinful nature. Come on, somebody. Where you have been your own worst enemy. Where all the choices that you made that exploded in your face were, well, yours. The message of the gospel this morning is that God can turn any defeat into victory. Whatever failure you've experienced, God can renew, restore, and rebuild your life.
Yes, amen.
That's his promise to you. You probably do not remember his name, but his name is Nikolai Ivanovich Bukharin. During his day, he was as powerful a man as there was anywhere on earth. He was a Russian communist leader. He took part in the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917. He was editor of the Soviet newspaper Pravda, which, by the way, means truth. And he was a full member of the Politburo. His works on economics and political science are still read today in universities all over the world. There is a story told about a journey he took from Moscow to Kiev in 1930 to address a huge assembly on the subject of atheism. You see, he was a devout atheist. Addressing the crowd, he aimed his heavy artillery at Christianity, hurling insult after insult and argument after argument and proof against Christianity as being a viable thought pattern or religion. An hour later, it took him an hour, he was finished. He had dismantled in his mind Christianity. He looked out at what seemed to be the smoldering ashes of men's faith, and he says, "Are there any questions?" He demanded, not really asked. Deafening silence filled the auditorium. But then one man approached the platform and mounted the lectern, standing near the communist leader. He surveyed the crowd first to the left, then to the right. Finally, he shouted the ancient greeting known well in the Russian Orthodox Church. He shouted, "Christ is risen!" En masse, the crowd arose as one man. The response came crashing like the sound of thunder. "He is risen indeed!" The entire crowd, en masse. I say to you this morning, Christ is risen. Come on. I am convinced he rose from the dead and he will come again in glory. This is Easter. And to stand here on this day and in this pulpit and proclaim this word, I cannot begin to tell you how this defines who I am. A resurrection that conquers defeat. Jeremiah 31 verse 4, "Again I will build you, and you shall be rebuilt, O Virgin of Israel. You shall again be adorned with the tambourines and shall go forth in the dances of those who rejoice." I like the emphasis in these words. When God rebuilds, you are rebuilt. Did you hear me? When God rebuilds, you are rebuilt. I said, when God rebuilds, you are rebuilt. Totally and completely. If we are defeated by life, God can rebuild us. John 20, verse 1 through 5, Mary Magdalene. She goes into the tomb early. It's still dark. She sees that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. It was not rolled away. It was tossed away in the middle of the night as Jesus rose from the dead. Then she ran to Simon Peter and she told them. She ran and said, "Look, the tomb is empty. The stone is gone." And immediately they started bolting out of the room to follow her to the empty tomb. And there was Peter and there was John. John's the one writing the book. And Peter went out, the other disciple. Peter raced out first. They both ran together. And John outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Now there's a reason for this, I believe. Bear with me. Peter was strong and he was fit. He was a fisherman. He ran to the tomb. But I can't help wonder if he ran with complete conviction. You see, our text says that the other disciple, John, outran him. Is it possible that Peter wavered? Because if you remember, Peter was the one that the last thing he did before he saw Jesus or before he might confront an empty tomb, the last thing he did was deny Jesus Christ three times. And the Bible says you will hear the crow of the rooster. And so the crow of the rooster was a reminder that Peter had failed, that he had denied his Savior. And so as soon as he heard the news, "The tomb is empty," he tore out of the room and started running full speed. And then the crow of the rooster, come on somebody, started banging in his head. "You're going to see Jesus. You're going to see the risen Lord. You thought you'd never see him again, but you're about to see him. And he's going to look at you. And you remember," the crow of the rooster banging his head, "you remember you failed him. You denied him. The last thing he knows about you is you are a failure and a denier that he even existed, that you were even a part of him." He heard the rooster crow again in his head. Every reminder of his time with Jesus, all the wonderful moments together, vision and destiny, only sought to remind Peter of his failure as the rooster crowed in his head. How about you? Are you living with regret? Amen, this morning. Are you not able to overcome the failures of your life, of the past? Is the rooster's crow of failure banging in your head with every attempt at success in life? Is it possible that you are not truly committed to the things of God because inside your mind you think you're just going to fail? I don't want these people to know it, but it's just setting myself up for failure. And it's just going to come a point in time when I will fail these people, so I will keep a hand's distance back. That way they won't count on me. That way they won't put their all of their hearts in with mine. That way we won't build actual lasting relationships because I'm just going to fail. I'll fail at everything. And it's just a matter of time. Maybe that's happening in your mind. Maybe too many people will never overcome this. They fail openly. Then they hide in shame. Church, listen to me. When there is hope at the cross and in an empty tomb, there is hope at the cross and in an empty tomb. I said there's hope at the cross and in an empty tomb. Amen. But not long after this, Jesus meets up with Peter himself. He allows Peter to reaffirm his love for him 3 times. Yes, you guessed it, just as many times as Peter denied him, Jesus is allowing him to reaffirm his love. And the rest is history. Your defeats may threaten your career, your marriage, your family, your finances, or your soul. But God can turn any defeat this morning into victory. If you will put your faith in Him, if you will hold on to the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, amen, things can change. He will rebuild you and restore you. See, the resurrection inhabits us. It becomes a part of us. The resurrection power lives inside of us. Romans 8, verse 9. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. Romans 8, verse 11. Here it is. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life, resurrection life to your mortal bodies. That's what the scripture says. Through His Spirit who dwells in you, that God has given within us, amen, His resurrection Spirit to raise us from the dead, to bring us out of sin, to raise us to a place where we need to be, to raise us up, amen, into the gate, back to where we need to be, to doing something great for God. Amen. 1 Corinthians 3:16, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? See, this is a great mystery. It is. This is the secret revelation this morning that God alone knew and none of the rest of us knew. Even the rulers of the ages, the devil himself, did not know who they were dealing with. That the death of Jesus would kill sin and that they would kill the sin nature in man and that the resurrection Spirit would be imparted into mankind and raise him up from death. Amen. Caused by sin. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 8, which none of the rulers of this age known, for had they known this, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. See, had they known this, they wouldn't have been so quick, amen, to kill him on the cross. But listen to me, they did not know that the resurrection of Jesus Christ would kill sin and would raise up, amen, sinners into new life in Christ. The devil did not know he was about to lose billions of souls by nailing Jesus on the cross. When you experience defeat, it sometimes seems that you'll never be able to laugh again. That the dark cloud of defeat will haunt you forever. Don't get me wrong, sin is sin. I understand it has horrible consequences. I'm not trying to diminish the seriousness of sin in our lives. But I want to emphasize this morning that as destructive as sin can be, God's forgiveness is even greater. Yes. Amen. God's forgiveness is even greater. Hallelujah. There is no sin that is too great for His mercy to cover. Amen. God took radical steps, amen, through the death of His only Son on the cross to atone for your sins, to make up for where you fell short. Your guilt, wrath of judgment on you is covered by the blood of Jesus. God can take any defeat and turn it into victory. Yes. Why? Amen. How? Because his resurrection spirit, the spirit of God that defeats death, dwells, inhabits you.
Yeah.
It dwells in you. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you and can raise you from death and sin. Here's the good news. Here's the good news. Are you ready? It's not too late for you.
Amen.
That is good news, isn't it? I said it's not too late for you. As Jesus hung on that cross, all of your sins, all of your failures, all of your defeat was placed on him. He paid the price for it all. The weight of our sins was so great that it cost him his life. But as you already know, death wasn't the end, church. On Sunday morning, Easter day, Jesus was resurrected. That's what we're celebrating this morning. See, this wasn't merely a spiritual resurrection. He didn't come back as a ghost, as so many think. I'm not gonna belabor you with theology, although I can. I'm not gonna do that. The body that died and was placed in the tomb was dead. Jesus was dead. His heart had stopped beating, his lungs had stopped breathing, his blood had stopped flowing, and through his veins, he was completely and utterly lifeless. He was completely dead. And yet, while he was in the tomb, something happened. The Spirit of God, amen, entered that tomb, listen to me, church, and touched that dead body, amen, in Jesus, of Jesus Christ. And his heart began to beat again. His lungs filled with air. His blood began to flow. Amen. His eyes opened. He stood to his feet. He had been dead as a man could be. And now he was alive. And he is alive to this very day. We serve a God that's alive. Then there was me. March 20th, 1983. I lay as dead in my sin. My life was struggling for a pulse. Sin was reigning supreme in my heart. My mothers are here. I'm not going to go into detail. I'm sorry, Mom, there are things you don't know. But as I bowed my knee, with just a tiny, oh, come on, you got to hear me this morning, a tiny, ever so tiny bit of faith, and just a twinge of anguished hope, lying in my tomb of despair, something happened. The Spirit of God entered that tomb, oh God, and touched my dead body. And my heart began to beat again. My lungs filled with pneuma, which is the word for the breath of life, the Spirit of God, amen. And my newly spiritualated, I just made that word up, spiritualated. My newly spiritualated blood began to flow. I like it. It's a word now. My eyes opened. I stood to my feet. Why? Because I was spiritualated. Yeah. A child of God with destiny. Come on. Yeah. Purpose. The spirit of resurrection living inside of me spiritualated me. Yeah. I've never turned back. 1983 to God help me. Who knows what year it is now. Hallelujah. I asked my mom, what do you feel about having a son that's 55? She said, I have a son that's 57. I said, God help me. See, today matters. Amen. Today matters. Our choices make tomorrow better. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ is for today. What a pity it would be. And there are churches that believe there are no miracles. There are churches that believe that the miracles died to the apostles. There are churches that believe there's no supernatural move of God in this generation. What a pity to believe that the resurrection of Jesus Christ died with that generation. What a horrible thought. What a horrible thought that we cannot be powerfully touched by God. See, today matters. Our choices make tomorrow better. We all want tomorrow to be better, don't we? Amen. Too many of us have lost faith that today matters. We have lost faith in the power of God. Some of us have lost faith that we can change. We've lost faith that we can make a spiritual comeback. We've lost faith that anything matters. We've lost faith that there's anything we can do to make a difference. Come on. As a result of that lost faith, we have grown comfortable and accepting that God is done with us, that there's really not much else He can do, that He's not with us, that our lives are moving forward in a plane that we did not intend and we don't like, and we think there's nothing God can do to get that turned around, that there's no way that God can get us back on track, that it's impossible. And He no longer even hears our answers to our prayers, or hears or answers our prayers. This is what the resurrection is for. Not only did Jesus Christ rise from the dead, He also rose others from the dead. Amen. Showing His power over death long before He raised Himself. I want you to hear me. So when Romans 8:11 speaks of that resurrection spirit living inside of me, I understand that to be true. Why? Because He set the precedent long ago. We need to believe that this morning. Regardless of what has happened previously in our lives and in our faith, that today's choices, that what we do today, in His resurrection spirit, can make tomorrow better. Amen. See, God stoops down to make you great. You never heard this before? I said, God stoops down to make you great. Listen to this. 2 Samuel 36:37. It's the New Century Version, NCV, because I think it says it best. 36, you protect me with your saving shield. You have stooped to make me great. You give me a better way to live, so I live as you want me to live. You've given me a better way to live, so I live as you want me to live. See, if we are going to believe that today matters, if we're going to make the choices today to make tomorrow better, then we must believe that God can stoop down to make us great. That God can stoop down. He sent His only Son to live on the earth as a man, fully God, fully man, to stoop down and to pick us up. To stoop down. You know, when my kids were little, I would run full speed. And with one hand, I would lean over and scoop them up when they were going too close to the road. Come on. Scoop them up. I would do anything. I remember when my daughter Brianna, I know she's here. Where is she? My daughter Brianna was drowning. Victoria Bay in South Africa. She was drowning. She was going down. She still won't go in water that doesn't have like a blue painting on the bottom floor. She was drowning, and I can remember running from way back. I was off the beach. I was reading a book way back, and I remember running full speed. I remember going into that water. I remember hitting some rocks because she was way off the beaten path. And I remember diving over some rocks, and I went into a deep hole, and I came up. I'm climbing myself, and I'm cutting my chest and scraping myself on these rocks, and I'm pulling myself over, and I'm praying, "Oh, God, let me get there." I could not believe how long it was. I could not believe it. Just then, a handsome stud on a surfboard. Right? She's quietly got a picture of him in her phone, I'll bet. On his surfboard, he like one hand, one like one foot in the air, like. Like a chum. All scratched up, still 30 feet away from her. Trying to figure out how you just stole my thunder. See, God stoops down to give us a better way to live. Come on. He wants us to be great. He wants those things that we choose to do in our lives to honor Him. He wants to do that. His resurrection spirit in us paves the way for our transcendent nature to rise up, to inspire, to be dedicated, to be people of initiative, so that we can make impact on others. He gives us a better way to live. To make today matter, we have three decisions to make. And I'm closing with this. Three quick decisions. Number one, we need to expect more of God in prayer. We need to go into prayer with expectation. We need to believe God. Amen. For more. Psalms 5:1-3. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my groaning. Give attention to the sound of my cry, my King and my God. For to you do I pray. hear my voice. In the morning, I prepare a sacrifice for you and watch. Do these words describe your prayer life? The confidence, the boldness, the request, the consistency, the expectations being placed on God to come through and answer them. Does that mimic your prayer life? What are we requesting from God? How do you believe God when you pray? Is it big? Is it life-changing? Or are you afraid to ask anything hard of God? And God says all along, is there anything too hard for me? Are we using our mornings to cry out to God? Or are we putting it off for some more convenient time? It takes faith to expect more from God. More faith in God, the more expectation for God to come through. Why would someone not pray much or expect much from God? Consider this. We throw expectations out the door when we fear disappointment. See, this is the problem. We think if we don't get our hopes up, then we won't have to be let down. We think that if we don't believe that our prayers will be answered, then we won't be despaired when they're not. However, if we're going to make tomorrow better, church, we have to expect more from God and believe that He won't let us down. Number two, expect more from yourself. The book of Haggai, who's a prophet, chapter 1, verse 2. Thus says the Lord of hosts, these people say that the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. See, the people were saying it's not time to build the Lord's house. They're saying, I don't have the time to think about God's house. That's what resurrection life is all about. It's about rebuilding your life so that you can build the house of God. Amen. It's about having everything you need to get the job done. That's what resurrection is about. When it comes to your relationship with God, what do you expect from yourself? Why do we give up so fast? Why do you give up so fast? When I was in the world, partying like it was 1982, because it was. I stayed out for days at a time. Literally. I pushed sleep out of my life to get things done because sin and the world demanded so much from me. I worked hard to sin. And I was a radical, committed, dedicated sinner. And there was nothing going to slow me down. When I went into that bar with a full paycheck, I didn't question the bartender and say, all you want is my money. You don't even love me. You don't even like me. You just want my money. If I didn't have any cash, you wouldn't sit here and talk to me like you do. No, I didn't do that. I expected the bartender. I buy the drinks, he takes the money. Come into church, we pull an offering, it's like, all he wants is my money. First time I went into church, I said, this is it. He pulled me up, I said, this is it. This is the whole reason these people are nice to me. They just want my money. And then God reminded me, I don't have any money. There must be something else they want. I don't know what it could be. I mean, I'm sitting there partying like it's 1982, and I'm doing whatever it takes to be that guy. Now we're Christians. We can't even come to church on Sunday morning because we're up past 9 o'clock on Saturday night. Are you kidding me? When you were in the world, you didn't even start Saturday night till after 9 o'clock. If you went in at 2 a.m., you're saying I'm retiring early. Nothing happened, I might as well go home. It's 2 a.m. I'm a four man myself. You know what I mean? Staying up as late. This is the sad part. You're staying up as late as the bars will let you. When they say, last call, get out of here. Now you barely come to church and you can't wait to get home.
Come on now.
You barely come to church and you can't wait to get home. Amen. New rule in the potty's house. Never stop the kid giving the pastor a cupcake. New rule. So I wonder, can be a friend to you, but you're not really a friend to them. Third thing, resurrection is for running the race today. 1 Corinthians 9:24. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run and you may obtain it. Amen. Success doesn't just occur one day in our lives. Every day of our life is preparation for the next. What or who we become is a result of the price we're willing or unwilling to pay. Are you willing to pay the price to make tomorrow better? What price do we need to pay in our relationship with God so that it's better, so that it's stronger? What price do we need to pay in our relationships so that we're no longer alone, isolated, distant, and stuck? We all want tomorrow to be better. That's why today matters. That's why this morning matters. That's why the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead matters. That's why we're here today. Because tomorrow can only be better if the Spirit of God that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. Let's bow our heads. Close our eyes for just a moment this morning. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead matters this morning. If you're here this morning, you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You are so blessed. I remember sitting in a Bible study. And I remember being led to a relationship with Jesus Christ. I didn't really understand what it was all about. I had very, very little faith. Not much understanding. Yet I knew that I had made a mess out of my life. When your mother tells you, you better find religion or join the military or something, but you got to get out of where you're at. You know you got problems. I did both, by the way. I found Jesus and joined the military. But you're here this morning, you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking, well, I grew up a Catholic or I grew up Methodist. Or I grew up. I'm not worried about any of that. I'm talking about, do you have a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ? Because that's important for you to understand. That's what matters. It's not the sign on the door. It's whether or not you love God. Whether or not you need Jesus to forgive you of your sins. Whether or not you're ready to make that transition from the choices you're making and the mistakes you're making and the way you belong in the world that is over-promising and under-delivering and all that is a mess in your life that you have made. And you want these things to change. You want some of those dreams. You want your heart. Amen. You want things to change around. It's time for you to bow your head, bow your knee. It's time for you to turn away from the lying world that tells you over and over and over and knows how to make you happy, but does not. There is no happiness outside of a relationship with the God that created you. And if you're here this morning and you're not saved, you're not right with God, you're not born again, but you would like to give your life to Jesus, I just wonder if you could raise your hand. Put your hand up. Let us pray with you. Put your hand in the air. Let us believe God with you. Let us see your life change. Let us be with you and walk with you as you do this. Why don't you honor the Lord? You're here on Easter morning. He died a heinous death on the cross so that you could be made whole. Why can't you take this moment to honor that sacrifice and say, you know what? I will give my life to you, Lord. And I will try it your way. I've messed it up my way. I will try it your way. And quickly, with nobody looking around, every head's bowed, this is a private moment. I want you to honor one another. It's a private moment. Bow your head, close your eyes. And if anybody in here at all, you want to make this moment matter. You want to make tomorrow matter. You want your life to matter. You want to give your life to Jesus Christ. You want to make him your Lord and Savior. You lift up your hand quickly all over this place so I can see it. Put your hand up, Pastor. Pray for me. Anybody at all? Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Maybe you're backslidden away from God. You were saved at one time, but you're not living for God. You know full well you're not living for God. you're struggling, and you know if you stood before God, if you died and stood before God in the next moment, there would be some serious issues. You know it. You know it. You feel it. And you're feeling it now. Your heart is beating. And you know that there's some things you're missing. You would like to rededicate your life to Jesus this morning. You raise your hand. You're backslidden away from God. You lift your hand up, Pastor, pray for me. I want to rededicate my heart to Jesus. Put your hand up. If you're not hearing me, if you're not paying attention, then you've already lost something. You better be careful. Because if you can no longer hear God speaking to your heart, then you have problems, major problems. Because it won't be long before God will stop speaking to you at all. But right now, here this morning, you can hear him. So answer it. Lift up your hand. Pastor, pray for me. I want to change this around for a moment and talk to born-again Christians, talk to all of you that are here that believe yourself to be right with God, which must be everybody. Nobody's responded. And I want to ask you this question right now. What does the resurrection of the dead mean to you? What does Jesus rising from the dead, what does that mean to you? What does that matter to you? Are you still going through the same issues that the world goes through without any answers, and you're wondering how in the world is this happening? Why am I struggling? Why is my life look just like somebody that has no faith? What is wrong with me? Because you are not believing. You're not pushing through. You're not believing that God is able to turn it around. You're not believing that God, the Spirit that raised him from the dead, dwells in you. Amen. There's resurrection power. There's transcendent nature. There's the miracle power of God to change your life and turn it into something powerful, something amazing. And that can happen to you right here this morning. Resurrection Sunday should mean something. It should be a rededication of your heart to the power of God to change you, to become what you need to be, the vessel that you need to be to touch the world, to rise up, to inspire, to dedicate your heart and your life to be a person of initiative so that you can make impact on the world. This altar's open. You come and find a place to pray.